This lecture is going to look at the hypothesis testing for the difference between two population means when we have independent samples. This particular situation can arise when we have two different populations for which we have an interest in whether or not their means are the same or whether or not their means are different. For example, if we were interested in the average salary, starting salary for, say, an engineer in Ontario versus an engineer in Nova Scotia, these are two different populations. And we could then try to estimate the difference between the mean salaries for these two locations. We have other examples, such as we might want to look at the average household expenditure on, say, utilities in one part of Nova Scotia versus another. For example, we could be looking at Sydney versus Halifax, or Halifax versus Dartmouth. And so there's an average expenditure on utilities for homeowners in Halifax, and there's an average for homeowners in Dartmouth. But those two means may not be the same. So the question is, if they're different, what is the difference between them? And certainly hypothesis testing or confidence intervals can allow us to explore that question a bit further. So the outcome for today is to discuss the logic behind and demonstrate the techniques for using independent samples to test hypothesis and to develop interval estimates for the difference between two population means. So if we were to take a look at this, if we had these two populations, and there's a mean for population 1, mu 1, with a standard deviation, sigma 1, and there's a mean for population 2, with a standard deviation, sigma 2, we are interested in the difference between those two, mu 1 minus mu 2. And we could either find an interval estimate for that difference, or we could find, we could basically test a hypothesis about that difference. We could test the hypothesis that the means are different, or that mu 1 is greater than mu 2, or that mu 2 is greater than mu 1. So we certainly can do that with the models I'm about to show you. Now, just as in the case of a single sample problem, if we took a random sample from population 1, we will observe a sample mean, and we could call that x bar 1 for that sample, and there's a sample size n1, and there's a sample standard deviation s1. So we could generate that information from population 1. Similarly, we could take a random sample from population 2 and have n2 x bar 2 s2. And with that information, we could begin to test hypotheses or estimate the difference between those two population parameters. So just to kind of go quickly over the sort of framework of the background, we have independent samples, so samples selected from two or more populations, in such a way that the occurrence of the values in one sample does not influence the probability of values occurring in the other sample. So what we get if we select a random sample from Halifax should have no influence on the random sample for Dartmouth. That's essentially what we're saying. So estimation for two population means, we have two situations. Much as in the case of a single sample problem, we could either know the standard deviations of those populations, or maybe we don't know the standard deviations of these populations. And more than likely, we don't know them. So we're kind of dealing with the situation right here. But we usually start off with the assumption that we know them and just take a look at the model to begin with. Many of the same concepts and principles that we applied in the case of a single sample problem also applies in the case of a two problem. So if the population standard deviations are known, let's start with that case, in which case sigma 1 and sigma 2 are known, and we're trying to estimate the difference between mu 1 and mu 2, then the best point estimate for that difference is the difference between the sample means. So if we generated x bar 1 from a sample, x bar 2 from a sample, the difference between those two would be the estimate of mu 1 minus mu 2. In much the same way as we said before, that if we have a population with mean mu and we generate a sample mean x bar, that x bar is our current best estimate of mu. So in this case, x bar 1 minus x bar 2 is our best estimate of mu 1 minus mu 2, the difference between those two population means. In terms of the standard error, you may recall we said that the standard error of x bar was sigma over root n. Well, in this case, the standard error of x bar 1 minus x bar 2 is given by this formula right here. Okay? And we could actually prove that quite easily, but the mathematical proof is beyond the scope of our course. So we'll just accept that the standard error for this difference between the two sample means is given by the square root of sigma 1 squared over n1 plus sigma 2 squared over n2. Let me just ensure that we sort of understand the concept. The idea is that if we were to take samples from these two populations, mu 1, sigma 1, mu 2, sigma 2, every time we took a sample, we get an x bar 1, x bar 2, and then we have an occurrence of x bar 1 minus x bar 2. And that's the current estimate, or point estimate, of the difference between those two. If I took another pair of samples, I'll get another x bar 1 minus x bar 2. And if I took another pair of samples again, I get another one, x bar 1 minus x bar 2. So each of these differences represents one possible occurrence from many possible differences. So hence we have a distribution of the difference between these sample means. And that distribution has a mean itself, which is mu x bar 1 minus x bar 2. And it turns out that is equal to mu 1 minus mu 2 for the population when we generate all the possible differences. And the standard deviation, x bar 1 minus x bar 2, is the sum of the variances of the two sample means, and then we take the square root of that to give us a standard deviation. So sigma 1 squared over n1, that's basically the variance of x bar 1 plus sigma 2 squared over n2. So when we add those two variances, that gives us the variance of x bar 1 minus x bar 2. But to get the standard deviation, we must take the square root of the variance. So now that we know the population mean, we know the standard error, and we know the sample statistic as well. The sample statistic is x bar 1 minus x bar 2. You'll notice that we can generate the z value if the sampling distribution of x bar 1 minus x bar 2 is normal. And then, of course, we could also find the interval estimate. So here's our point estimate for mu 1 minus mu 2 would be x bar 1 minus x bar 2. Sampling error, we know sampling error is what? Is equal to the sample statistic minus a population parameter. So in this case, the sample statistic is x bar 1 minus x bar 2 minus mu 1 minus mu 2. All right, so population difference is mu 1 minus mu 2. Sample difference is x bar 1 minus x bar 2. And the standard error, we know is sigma x bar 1 minus x bar 2, and that's the square root of sigma 1 squared over n1, sigma 2 squared over n2. So given that we have these parts right here, I don't think it's too difficult to see that if our sampling distribution of the difference between the sample means is normal, and because the population standard deviations are known, the sampling distribution of x bar 1 minus x bar 2 would be a normal distribution. So essentially, this would be mu x bar 1 minus x bar 2, and this would be sigma x bar 1 minus x bar 2. All right? Those are subscripts. And so that's the sampling distribution of the difference between the sample means. So the z value for this, if we were trying to find probabilities, or if we want to express the sampling error in standard deviations, is sampling error x bar 1 minus x bar 2 minus mu 1 minus mu 2, that's the sampling error, in standard deviations. Well, we just divide it by the standard error. Sigma 1 squared n1 plus sigma 2 squared n2. So just basically follow the same logic from the single sample problems and you'll find exactly the same thing. So here we go. So this is a z value. So if we were to find if we had information about the population standard deviation and the population mean, that's for the differences, of course. If we got a sample difference x bar 1 minus x bar 2, then we could actually calculate a probability in much the same way. What if I got a sample x bar 1 minus x bar 2? Sample observation. What's the probability of observing that difference or even higher? We could certainly find the z value and find the area in the tail. Or it could be in the left tail. It could be down here. So all the same principles that we are already exposed to apply in this case. Okay? If we wanted an interval estimate, so that's the z value for calculating probabilities. But if we wanted an interval estimate, what would that look like? Well, just recall the formula for an interval estimate. The formula for an interval estimate is the point estimate plus or minus the critical value times the standard error. That is not changing. So if we keep that in mind, we could easily produce a confidence interval for the difference between the population means. And here we go. It would be like this. What's our point estimate? Well, our point estimate would be the difference between the two sample means, in which case this is x bar 1 minus x bar 2. And then what's the critical value? Critical value in this case is z, because our sampling distribution for the difference between the sample means is a normal distribution. Sigma 1 and sigma 2 are known. So that's z. And then multiply by the standard error, which we know is sigma 1 squared over n1, sigma 2 squared over n2. And then we could get a confidence interval. So if we want a 95% confidence interval, our z is 1.96. A 98% confidence interval, 2.33. 99% confidence interval, 2.58. A 90% confidence interval is 1.64. So we can now find confidence intervals, and we now have the test statistic. This is the same as a test statistic. Remember that we said that a test statistic is essentially the sampling error in standard deviations. It measures how far that sample statistic is from the population mean. And the further it is away, the less that that particular sample looks like your population mean, like it belongs to that family of values. So if you get very large Z values or T values, then in a case like that, we would basically say that this particular sample that we've observed does not belong to the family of differences between sample means. And then it causes us to question our assumption about the population mean. So we now have the test statistic. We now have the information for a confidence interval right here. And we should be able to apply those two concepts, because we're already familiar with them, to different problem scenarios, which we'll do in a separate video. So here's the confidence interval, as I mentioned. It's right here. Point estimate, critical value, and our standard error. And these are different Z values. For 80%, which we really actually get an 80%, 1.28, but 90, 95, 99, and we could add 98% at 2.33. Okay? That should be fine. So for confidence intervals, we define a population parameter of interest, which would be mu1 minus mu2 or mu2 minus mu1. It doesn't matter. Specify the confidence level. Compute the point estimate. Determine the standard error of the sampling distribution. Determine the critical value, Z in this case, and develop the confidence interval estimate. It's fairly straightforward. The steps are the same as a single sample problem. The formula is just slightly different. Here's an example. The objective is to estimate the difference in the mean time spent per visit for male and female customers. So we see males and females as being two separate groups. Previous studies indicate that the standard deviation is 11 minutes for males and 16 minutes for females. We're not going to question that. We're just going to accept those values for now. Develop a 95% confidence interval estimate for the difference in the mean times. Okay? So for us to do that, of course, we will need some sample values. A random sample would have to be taken, and then we would need the sample means. So here's a case where we select the independent samples from the two populations, and just specify our desired confidence level. So we know it's 95%. We know the population standard deviations. The two sample sizes are the same. 100 for population 1, 100 for population 2. So let's assume 1 would be the population for males, 2 the population for females. It could be either way, it doesn't matter. And then the average time taken for males in this case, 34.5, for females, 42.4. So the sample difference is x bar 1 minus x bar 2, which is 7.9. And we're assuming that's minutes. So in other words, from the sample, it's looking like more time is actually spent per visit for each visit for females compared to males. That's just in the sample. But let's actually find a confidence interval for that. If we find a confidence interval, here's what we get. So we need the standard error, and you could see this calculation right here gives us the standard error. And so in applying our formula for confidence interval, here's our point estimate, which is 7.9. Here's our critical value, 1.96, associated with a 95% confidence interval. And then we have the standard error, which is 1.946. So basically, it would look something like this. Negative 7.9 plus or minus 1.96. So that's a Z value, and the standard error is 1.9416, which basically gives us negative 7.9 plus or minus 3.8056 minutes. If you look at that value of 3.8056, that's the margin of error, which we've often talked about. And so let's calculate the final value then for this problem. So when we compute or we sort of expand that interval, it will look something like this, that the confidence interval for mu1 minus mu2, we must add the negative 7.9 to the positive 3.8056. So when we add those two values, so be careful, one is negative, one is positive. So if you're subtracting 7.9 from 3.846, so whichever way you want to do it. So the two numbers are as follows. And then one, of course, you're subtracting 3.8056 from negative 7.9. It turns out that we would have the following values, that the difference between mu1 minus mu2 is greater than -11.7056 or -4.0944. And that's in minutes. So that's the confidence interval. Mu1 minus mu2 lies somewhere between -11.056 and minutes and -4.0944 minutes. Now, a lot of people have difficulty handling a negative value or interpreting negative differences. One of the things that's interesting is to look at is that both of the limits are negative. So any value in that interval will be a negative value. Let's just call it minus V. Any value in that interval will be negative. Well, if any value in that interval is negative, we're saying mu1 minus mu2 is a negative value. The difference between those two is negative, which suggests that mu2 must be larger than mu1. The only way you can get a negative difference from subtracting mu2 from mu1 is if mu2 is larger than mu1. So we actually have evidence from this interval that mu2 is greater than mu1. Okay, so let me explain that again. If we look at both of the limits of the interval, they are both negative. Because they are both negative, and this is a confidence interval for the difference between those two means, mu1 minus mu2, any value in that range is a negative value. So since mu1 minus mu2, the difference between them is a negative value, the only way to get a negative result is if mu2 is greater than mu1. So hence we have this result right here. Mu2 is greater than mu1. So we have evidence that women on average spend more time, if women are mu2, spend more time than per visit than men. Now, as I mentioned, a lot of people have some difficulty with dealing with negative signs. Had I changed around the difference to mu2 minus mu1, we would have had the following interval, mu2 minus mu1, and then here's what we would have had. It would be, the difference would be greater than 4.0944 and less than 11.7056. So one of the things I tend to do is I look at which sample mean is greater and I flip the difference. The interpretation is the same, but some people are more comfortable working with positive differences. So am I. So if you look at this, if I flip them to mu2 minus mu1, then in our sample statistic, we would have taken 42.4 minus 34.5. This up here. Okay? And then we would have had a positive interval. Now in this case, every value in that interval is positive. Well, if every value in the interval is positive, it must mean that mu2 has to be larger than mu1. Well, isn't that the same result earlier? It is exactly the same result. So if you ask the question, is there evidence that mu2 is larger than mu1? Your answer should be yes. Because the difference, we have a confidence interval where we are 95% confident that the difference is some positive value, which suggests that mu2 is greater than mu1, because that's the only way you could get a positive difference. If we're looking at mu2 minus mu1, or in this interval, we have a negative difference. The only way to get a negative difference is if mu2 is bigger than mu1. Same result, okay? So I hope that's a bit clear here. Now, that was the case when the population standard deviations are known. What if the population standard deviations are not known? But we've already been through this. We use a t-distribution. And all we know you need to do now is to change the formula to reflect a t-distribution. It's a little bit different. Notice this is our point estimate. Our critical value is a t-value, but then our standard error is given by a different formula, which is this piece right here. That's our standard error. Our standard error is sp squared over n1 plus sp squared over n2, and we take the square root of all of that. It's up here, it's written where we factored out the sp. If we factor it out, then it, when it gets outside of the square root, it just becomes sp. So in here is sp squared, but when we move it outside, it becomes sp. So what is this sp? Well, we refer to sp as a pool sample standard deviation, a pool standard deviation. And it's important to understand where that comes from. But here's the formula for the pool standard deviation. Sp is equal to the square root of n1 minus 1 times S1 squared, and S1 would be the standard deviation from sample 1, plus N2 minus 1 times S2 squared, where S2 would be the standard deviation from sample 2. And N1 plus N2 minus 2, that is actually the degrees of freedom associated with this particular model. Okay? So, the question is, where did this SP thing come from? Well, SP comes from the following. To do this analysis, we make an assumption about these two populations. We say that while they may have the same mean, different mean, their standard deviations are equal. In other words, sigma 1 is equal to sigma 2 is equal to some standard deviation sigma. That's an assumption to make the analysis manageable. If we don't make that assumption, we have a very challenging problem on our hands. So this is the assumption that the two populations have the same standard deviation. So if they have the same standard deviation, here's the issue. When we take a sample from each one, we would have S1 from sample 1 and S2 from sample 2. It is not likely that those two are equal. So since those two are not equal, how could we estimate a single value with two different values? In other words, for this population, here's what our standard error would look like. S sigma squared over N1, sigma squared over N2. That's what our standard error should look like. But when we don't have sigma, we cannot replace that with S1 squared over N1 plus S2 squared over N2. Why? Because we're saying that S1 squared is estimating sigma squared and S2 squared is estimating sigma squared, but S1 and S2 are not necessarily equal to each other. So how do we resolve this issue? We resolve that by pooling the information that we use to calculate those two standard deviations. Let me show you what I mean by that. So, to get S1 squared, the variance from sample 1, it is really the sum of X1 minus X bar 1 squared over N1 minus 1. That would be the variance of the first sample. The variance of the second sample is the sum of x, minus x bar 2 all squared over n2 minus 1. So they're quite similar. So what we do know is that s1 squared times n1 minus 1 is equal to the sum of xi minus x bar 1 squared. And similarly, S2 squared times N2 minus 1 is equal to the sum of xi minus x bar 2 all squared. So what we got to do is to combine, we will combine these sum of squares for the two samples and make one big sum of squares. All right? And then if we then divide that by the degrees of freedom, we will get the variance for the sample. So what we do is we say SP squared, which is the pooled variance squared, is the sum of the squares from the two populations. We join them together. So it would then be, and since we have a formula for this in S1 squared times N1 minus 1, and a formula for this one in S2 squared N2 minus 1, we will just take those terms instead. So it becomes S1 squared N1 minus 1 plus S2 squared N2 minus 1. So we're adding the sum of the squares together, and then we divide it by N1 minus 1 plus N2 minus 1, which gives us N1 minus 1 plus N2 minus 1. So you see we're also pooling the degrees of freedom as well. So now the variance, because if you notice over here, variance is sum of squares divided by degrees of freedom. Variance, I forgot to put the squared over here, is the sum of squares divided by the degrees of freedom. So the pooled variance would be the sum of squares divided by the degrees of freedom. So we're pooling the two samples together. So let's add the sum of squares together, and let's add the degrees of freedom together. And when we do that, we get our single, we get finally, we will get SP is equal to the square root of SP squared, obviously. But we don't need to really write out this full formula right here. If we look at that, that would just be S1 squared N1 minus 1 plus S2 squared N2 minus 1 divided by N1 plus N2 minus 2. So that would give us our pool sample standard deviation. All right. So now, when we take that information and we put it in to this form where the standard error is equal to SP squared, that's the variance, over N1 plus SP squared over N2. We could factor out SP squared, and when we factor it out, we could put SP on the outside of the square root sign and have 1 over N1 plus 1 over N2. All right, which is what we see in the formula for the confidence interval. And then that brings us to this formula, which for our confidence interval, point estimate, x bar 1 minus x bar 2. Critical value is a t value with degrees of freedom N1 plus N2 minus 2. And then the standard error is SP times the square root of 1 over N1, 1 over N2. So handling the case where sigma or the standard deviations are unknown requires a little more work, but the principles are still the same. Point estimate, critical value, standard error. Okay? Still the same. Which then brings us to what then is the test statistic? Well, the test statistic, you may recall, is the sampling error divided by the standard error. We already know what the standard error is, so we simply need the sampling error, and that helps us to. So in this case, our test statistic T is x bar 1 minus x bar 2. Remember, point estimate or sample statistic minus population parameter. So that's our sampling error divided by the standard error. In this case, is SP into 1 over N1, 1 over N2. And that will be our test statistic where the degrees of freedom is N1 minus 1 plus N2 minus 1. But that works out to be N1 plus N2 minus 2, which is what you would see in your textbook. And then we could use that information to go ahead and do all sorts of things with the t-distribution. So to get a confidence interval for the case for mu1 minus mu2, when sigma1 and sigma2 are unknown, We follow the same set of steps. Define a population parameter of interest. Specify the confidence level. Compute the point estimate. Get the standard error of the sampling distribution. Determine the critical t-value. And develop the confidence interval. The important thing for you to remember is how you calculate the t-value. And remember, if we know the confidence level, we could get it, and the degrees of freedom, we could certainly calculate the critical value. So up to this point, we have looked at the confidence intervals for the difference between two population means, when the population standard deviations are known, and the case when they are unknown. When they are known, we use the sampling distribution of the difference between the means to be normal. And then when they are unknown, we use the t-distribution. I also actually went one step further and gave you the test statistics, which we use in hypothesis testing. So in hypothesis testing, I'm just going to go over the next couple of slides very quickly, just as an overview. And then we will have worked examples that demonstrate the models in hypothesis testing. So in the case where we have a hypothesis test for the difference between two population means, of course, we still have the same two scenarios where the standard deviations are known and the standard deviations are unknown. We assume that the samples are independent. Now, when the population standard deviations are known, the sample size is immaterial. But if the standard deviations are not known, if the sample sizes are small, we definitely will use T. If they are large, we could still use T. But remember, we could apply the central limit theorem that suggests that as the sample sizes get large, the sampling distribution becomes approximately normal. And in that case, we require both samples, N1 and N2, to be greater than or equal to 30. Not one of them, but both of them. If any one of the two is less than 30, we must use the t-distribution. So keep that in mind. In terms of the hypotheses that we could test, I think it's just always remember that the null hypothesis always contains the equal sign. And we have three variations. One is where we could assume that the means are the same, and we refer to that as a two-tailed test or a non-directional test. The means are the same. So two-tailed tests. And you see here in the null hypothesis, we'll assume that the difference is zero, versus the research hypothesis, which says that the difference is not zero. Okay? So if the two means are not the same, the difference between them cannot be zero. We have two situations where we have a one-tailed test, or these are directional tests. Both of these here are directional tests, where we're now going to try the test, for example, mu1 is less than mu2. So that means the difference between those two would be negative. And so our null hypothesis would be the opposite of that, is that the difference between them is equal to zero or positive. But here we are looking for evidence that the difference is negative, which means mu2 is larger than mu1. Here, a one-tailed test, upper-tailed test. So if we want the difference mu1 to be greater than mu2, then the difference between mu1 and mu2 would be positive, and which means our null hypothesis would be the opposite of that. Either there's no difference between them, or that difference is negative. So or we could frame the hypothesis this way. It's good to frame it as a difference, because then it lets you know exactly how you should set up the sample statistic. So in the case of, if your alternate hypothesis says mu1 minus mu2, then you would simply take x bar 1 minus x bar 2. I do want you to know, however, you do not always have to frame it mu1 minus mu2. You could always frame mu2 minus mu1. So in the case where we say mu1 minus mu2 is less than 0, then you could reverse that and say mu2 minus mu1 is greater than 0. And then in the case where we say mu1 minus mu2 is greater than 0, then it means mu2 minus mu1 is less than 0. So it's very easy to just switch them. You get exactly the same results. Okay? But what you have to do is to pay attention to the problem context and have the research hypothesis in such a way that It's your decision rules and your rejection regions all make sense. That's pretty much what you have to ensure. The steps are our usual steps. Specify the significance level. And then we determine the rejection regions, compute the test statistic and the p-value, reach a decision, draw a conclusion. These are the same five steps we use in single sample problems versus two sample problems. So here's an example of a one-tailed test, a lower-tailed test. The company is interested in determining whether there is a difference in the average thickness of a brick facing products made at two plants, plant one and plant two. So those are the two different populations. You see here, X bar one is 0.501 and X bar 2.509, suggesting that it's slightly thicker for plant two. The population standard deviations are known, so we know we're going to use Z. And so our hypotheses would be that the average for plant one is less than the average for plant two, or mu one minus mu two is less than or equal to zero. So if you take a look here, that's consistent. If mu one is less than mu two, then mu one minus mu two should be less than or equal to zero. Rejection region would be in the left tail. So if you look at the direction of the inequality here, it's pointing to the left. So that's a left tail test. If our alpha value is 5%, then our critical Z value is negative 1.645. We're on the left of the zero. Here's our formula. Test statistic, which I've already shown you. And when we substitute the values, we have a value of negative 1.90. That value falls in the rejection region because the limit of the rejection region is negative 1.645. So you go beyond that, you are now in the rejection region and you should reject the null hypothesis. We have evidence that the, that mu1 is less than mu2. We could also find the p-value by just finding the probability associated with negative 1.90 and compare it to 5%. I'm sure you'll find that it's actually less than 5% because it has to be consistent with the rule that we just applied here, this rule. Negative 1.9 is less than negative 1.645, so therefore the p-value must be less than that value as well. So the p-value is less than alpha, reject the null hypothesis, otherwise don't reject. In this particular case, we have, this is our observed z-value. When we look that up, here's the area between the 0 and Z, subtracted from 0.5, we'll get 2.87% as our observed significance, the p-value, which is less than 5%. So since the amount of risk that we're willing to take, or that the amount of risk associated with the sample is 2.87%, but we are willing to take up to 5% risk of committing type 1 error, we'll reject the null hypothesis. So we come to the exact same conclusion. Our p-value is indeed smaller than alpha. If we were dealing with a case where we have sigma 1 and sigma 2 are unknown, then we would have to handle the entire problem differently using this as our test statistic. And we've gone through this. So for this example, we have, suppose an independent test agency wishes to conduct a test to determine whether name brand ink cartridges generate more color pages on average than competing generic ink cartridges. So we have the samples are small, 15, but they could be larger, like 30, 40, 50. It's still a T distribution, but we can use the central limit theorem and then assume that the sampling distribution is normal. But for now, our sample sizes are small. So X bar 1, the number, I guess that would be the number of pages printed, is 211, so that's the name brand. 2119.7 is the average, and then versus 1777.7. We have our standard deviations of 709.7 and 593.9. So the population standard deviations are not known in this case. So we would have to use the T distribution. And we have in this case, we want to know if there is a difference between them. Oh, no, sorry, actually, it says more color pages on average. So that's really a two-tailed test. If you look at the hypothesis stated, that's an error in the text. That's not correct because it says here, if the name brand ink generates more color pages. So that really should have been, if mu1 is the name brand, our hypothesis should be HA, mu1 minus mu2 is greater than 0. So that should be a one-tailed test, not a two-tailed test, in which case this needs to be repeated. But if you look at the t-value, it's small. And if we correct this to a one-tailed test, I'm sure that we still would not be in the rejection region. Now, if we wanted to make this a two-tailed test, as the calculations here suggest, we would have to say, conduct a test to determine whether there is a difference between the mean number of color pages printed from generic and name brand ink cartridges. And in which case, then this complete test will be a non-directional test because we're just interested in the difference between them. All right? However, there's an error in the text here, treating this as a two-tailed test when the question actually reads as a one-tailed test. But that's no big deal because I think we could wrap our heads around the error and understand that this now would be 5%. So a one-tailed test, and we would have to find the appropriate critical t-value, and do that and compare that appropriate t-value with 1.4313. But I think it would be safe to say that we would still not be in the rejection region. Why? Because I know that for a one-tailed test with 5% in the tail, if it were a normal distribution, the critical value would be Z is 1.645. T-values tend to be larger. So that particular T-value is actually going to be larger than 1.645, in which case the T-value of 1.4313 is actually smaller than that value. So I know we would not reject the null hypothesis. In which case we can commit type 2 error, failing to reject the null when it is false. Okay? And we would have insufficient evidence of a difference between the two types of cartridges, or we have insufficient evidence that the name brands actually produce more color pages than generic brands. So that brings us to the end of hypothesis testing and interval estimation for two population means when the samples are independent of each other. Okay, and we looked at the case where the population standard deviations are known and the case where the population standard deviations are unknown.